So, Lac, you've been at Google for only 2 years, which really surprised me because you've done so much since you've been here. But tell me about your journey getting here.
It's actually pretty interesting how I got to Google. I think I'm pretty non-traditional. I've been in academia near over 20 years. I was working at the National Severe Storms Laboratory, which is this weather research organization.
Okay.
And midlife crisis hit. And about 4 years ago, I decided to basically take a leave of absence, a year off, bring the wife and kids over. We came to Seattle. We basically joined a startup that essentially built machine learning algorithms for farmers.
Okay.
Now, we kind of are proud of how we're doing self-driving cars at Google.
Right.
But what people don't realize is that farming, at least in the United States, is extremely automated. There's lots of data that's being thrown about.
Mm-hmm.
Combines, tractors, they all have GPS units on them. So there's a lot of data being thrown about. And the idea is to basically improve farmers' yield by taking into account things like soil and weather and genomics, et cetera. And something that had happened at the startup that was very, very, very interesting was that just before I left NOAA, as it turned out, I didn't realize I was leaving NOAA, but I did, right? When I left NOAA, we had basically been building this program to process years and years of radar data. And we said, let's go back and take 15 years of data and apply these algorithms to it so that we can build something on top of that. And started to do that, and it took us about 4 years
okay.
to basically process 15 years of data.
Wow.
Come to the startup, we need to do the same thing. We need to build a good rainfall system. And the idea was we're not smart people, we have no ideas. Instead, what we'll do, we'll go look at all the papers that have been published on all the different ways to estimate rainfall, and we will basically do all of them and do an ensemble of them.
Okay.
So what we were doing at the startup was exactly what we were doing at NOAA,
okay.
except we essentially got this thing done every 2 weeks.
Instead of 4 years?
Instead of 4 years.
Right.
What was different?
Well, we're experts on rainfall in Seattle.
We're experts. Yeah. So it's probably that, the fact that we were in Seattle and we were motivated to do rainfall better. But also that the difference was that we were doing it on 70 machines
okay.
at my old job. And we were doing it on the cloud at massive scale
right.
in the new one. We couldn't afford to buy machines, so we were renting them. And that was one of the things that kind of blew my mind, that it completely changes the way we look at data. When things that take 4 years, you can do in 2 weeks.
Yeah, because you're not burdened with buying and owning and maintaining machines, right?
Exactly. So the infrastructure is a whole lot better. The second aspect, if you recall what happened in machine learning, just 2012, 2013, CNNs just burst onto the scene.
Okay.
And radar images, they're non-traditional images, but they're still images.
And CNN, convolutional neural networks.
Convolutional neural
networks. Not the news networks.
Yes. God, thank you. Convolutional neural networks completely changed the way we approach machine learning on images.
Mm-hmm.
So things that we would basically do handcrafted, we can now basically, the neural network learns on its own. I have this funny realization when I realized that, you know, there's this very famous graphic from Jan LeCun of how CNNs learn hierarchically.
Right.
So at the very bottom, it just learns colors and then edges and textures and so on. And somewhere in the third layer, it basically learns textures. And that's what my PhD thesis was 20 years ago.
Wow.
Right. So something I spent 4 years developing by hand, and the network just learns in a matter of hours.
How did that make you feel?
It made me feel a little, actually, not obsolete, but thrilled.
Yeah.
That
it's a vindication of your work, right?
It's this idea that things that used to be so hard, if they are now easy, we can now start to focus on things that were impossible before.
Exactly.
Right? It's
exactly.
that moving up the stack. Humans move up the stack as well.
Yep.
So it's like, okay, where do I go, right? Me asking myself 2 years ago, where do I go if I want to basically do cloud and I want to be at the forefront of machine learning?
Right.
And there's really no other place to be.
So now you're here working at Google and you're working, and I love your job title, right? You work with big data and machine learning.
Right.
You know, which is really nice to see the two of those together, because often we see big data and we see machine learning, and that tells me people don't understand the fundamentals. But when the two of them are connected, you know, that's just showing that the fundamentals are being misunderstood. So what is it that you're doing now?
Right. So I'm at Google Cloud. I'm part of what's called the Professional Services Organization.
Okay.
So we're the organization that helps our customers be successful on cloud by doing a few things. We do consulting, so we work with customers to help them build, in terms of machine learning, to help them build models.
Right.
But of course, as you know, you can't just go build a model. It's not, no one gives you a clean data set in real life. You have to
Wouldn't that be nice?
I think it would be not challenging if every time you just got a very clean data set and there's no depth to it at that point.
But I could do it not challenging once in a while. So you work with the data.
We work with our customers to help them formulate the machine learning problem in such a way that you can actually solve it, and to solve and then figure out what data sets they have, what data sets need to get collected, come up with a plan, a strategy. It's very rare that we can just go in and, although we've done it, where the customer actually has digital data, it's perfect because they've been doing human analysis on that, and we just turn that around and we figure out how to automate it. But those are the rare situations. I think like less than 10% of our engagements are that way.
Right.
So that's one part of what professional services does in terms of consulting. The other part that I'm super enthusiastic about as well is that we take what we learn from teaching our customers how to do things on cloud and how to be successful, and create coursework, create blog posts, create books, create samples to enable them to do these same things themselves.
And it's a great way to scale.
It's a great way to scale because, you know, ours is a team of a few hundred people. We're never going to be, I think, a services organization where we're primarily a product company.
Mm-hmm.
And as Google, we believe in building great products that scale well, that are very reliable, but that often require some amount of customer expertise and knowledge to be able to take advantage of. And so we're this glue between our product team and our customer teams.
And educating the customer, educating the individual developer, I know is something that you're passionate about. You've done a whole bunch of stuff in this area, including you've written one of those animal books at O'Reilly.
Right. I mean, that was funny, right? The animal book at O'Reilly came about very, in a kind of in an organic way. I joined Google Cloud, and I quickly realized that the way Google approached data and the way Google approached processing of data was fundamentally different from anything I'd done before, right? Everything I'd done before involved me thinking about Unix machines and installing software on Unix machines and doing the processing. And instead, Google was talking completely about fully managed services, just code. The idea was that as a data person, you wrote code and you handed it off to the system and it scaled it for you. And that was incredibly liberating,
right?
Where, you know, I could just write Python or Java and not worry about the system internals, right? Mm. But that was fundamentally different from what I had ever known before. And so I set out, said, okay, I'm gonna relearn everything that I think I know, how to do it the Google way. So I wrote code. I picked a problem, and I decided I would follow it from ingest all the way to real-time streaming machine learning, and do it along the way with all of the kinds of data science approaches, Bayesian things that you would do, machine learning with traditional models, machine learning with wide and deep networks, the whole shebang. So I did all of that, and I had all the code around, and someone at a Python meetup said, hey, Glack, could you come give us a talk? I said, okay, I'll just walk through the code. And I did. So I walked through the code to this Python meetup in Singapore, and the end of it, the unanimous feedback was, this is great, because it's end-to-end, it is a real-world example, it's code. No, we should do something more with this. And that's when I contacted O'Reilly and said, hey, can I wrap a book around this code?
Nice.
And that's how, so it's normally people write books and they write code. I wrote code and then I wrapped a book around it, which is kind of fun.
Which is also my way of doing it when I write books. I prefer to do that, come up with a couple of scenarios of how I would learn to do X, Y, and Z, and then, you know, build chapters.
And I think it keeps it much more real.
It makes it easier for the author too. Don't you find?
Absolutely, absolutely. Because once you know exactly where you're going and you know exactly, this is the stuff that we have to, I have to show people what it is. This is what I learned along the way. It is much easier to put that into words. It's much harder to do it step by step because you have no idea where a software project is going to take you.
Right, right.
Especially a software project that involves data analysis or machine learning. If you knew the answer, you wouldn't be doing it.
Exactly. Now, beyond books, you've also been doing like some courses, right? Writing
Correct.
Courses for Coursera and getting different Googlers to shoot them for you. So,
yeah, including you, Lawrence.
See, it's all about me. So tell us about the course. What's it like?
This course actually started out with customer engagements.
Okay.
And we'd basically been working with customers and helping them build ML models. And essentially, the immediate feedback we heard was, well, yeah, you've built all these things for us, but how do we take this forward? This is just one project. We want to basically transform our entire company with machine learning. And so what we wanted to do was to basically say, okay, how do you actually apply machine learning in practice? And that involves, how do you recognize a machine learning problem? How do you formulate it? What are some of the ethics things that you have to think about? And once you've decided that this is a problem that you want to solve, what are the steps towards solving it? How do you get the data? How do you do the feature engineering? What are some of the options available to you? How do you plan for streaming later on? And then, of course, how do you put models into production, which is where you came in, Lawrence. So thank you very much for providing some of that.
Well, thank you. It was something that I've been looking to learn. Mm-hmm. And so I was able to learn so much from this by reading through how you'd written the course. So it's like, yay, this is great. So it's a double bonus for me. So I hope students can learn it as well.
So I'm super thrilled in the sense that we basically were able to go from formulating an ML problem all the way to building really sophisticated image sequence and recommendation models.
Yep.
And in very practical terms, and to build a code that is very reusable that we have used in a variety of different customer engagements that our customers have also taken and used and adapted for their own needs.
Yep.
And I mean, part of doing a course like this is constantly keeping up to date. And you know, recently we announced AutoML and BigQuery ML and tensor processing units. And it's been fun to actually go back and take the courses that we've already shot and say, okay, now we need to add these other things because the better way to do these things has changed.
Yeah. Well, one of the things I really liked about it when I was looking through the material, and I hope students are able to benefit from it in the same way, is that how some very sophisticated scenarios are explained very simply. So for example, like distributed learning, mm-hmm. it's like, well, we all just think distributed learning is like, well, instead of throwing it at one machine, you throw it at a whole bunch of machines and it just works. Mm-hmm. But like some of the strategies that you need to follow to be very efficient in
Absolutely.
Distributed learning.
Absolutely. I mean, yeah. So you can throw it on a bunch of different machines, but when you throw it on a bunch of machines, there are different ways that you can throw it. You can split your model or you can split your data. And what you choose to do, surprisingly or not so surprisingly, has an impact on how fast it trains, how well it trains, and you choose different strategies for different types of models. Models that are sparse, you tend to split your data. Models that are deep, you tend to have your... So it's all of these kinds of real-world, practical rules of thumb, if you will. But these are things that work, that have been shown to work, and we basically synthesize it, and we... That's basically what we do in the course.
So for somebody who wants to get into machine learning, just going from end to end, from building their first model all the way through running it in production, it's a great course. But what's it called?
It's called Machine Learning on GCP. That's the first 5 courses. And Advanced Machine Learning on GCP, that's the next 5. So look for them, and you will find them linked from cloud.google.com/training/data-ml. You should see the link on the YouTube video.
Yeah, we'll put them in the description below. So thanks so much, Lack. This has been a whole lot of fun.
Thanks. It's been a lot of fun for me as well.
And thanks, everybody, for watching this episode of Coffee with a Googler. If you have any questions for me or if you have any questions for Lack, just please leave them in the comments below. Whatever you do, don't forget to hit that subscribe button. Thank you.